start with this. Well, I'm sure that most of you have heard by now. DAZN announced that beginning December 1st, they're going to be launching in 200-plus countries and territories globally with an initial monthly price of $1.99. That's $1.99 in pounds, not U.S. dollars or less. Boxing fans will enjoy back-to-back weekends featuring Ryan Garcia, Luke Campbell, Anthony Joshua, and Kubrat Pulev. Per a tweet from Michael Benson, DAZN will launch in the UK with Ryan Garcia versus Luke Campbell on December 5th. Main event expected around midnight UK time. This is part of DAZN's full global launch, which sees the service expand to 200-plus countries and territories. Initial price is $1.99 per month. Both events will start at 7 p.m. Eastern time. Garcia Campbell will be streamed on DAZN everywhere but Poland. Joshua Pulev won't be available on DAZN in the UK or Ireland. If you're in those territories, you'll likely see that fight on Sky Sports. Sky Sports pay-per-view. Now, this isn't really confusing, though it does require some clarification. Whoever was a Sky Sports fighter before DAZN launches in the United Kingdom will still be a Sky Sports fighter after they launch in the United Kingdom. Guys like Anthony Joshua, Dillian White, Derek Chisora, Katie Taylor. If you're in the United Kingdom and you want to take in one of their fights, you're still going to see it on Sky Sports. It's the Matchroom USA fighters that you'll find on DAZN. That's Daniel Jacobs, Demetrius Andre, Chocolatito, Juan Francisco Estrada, and several others. I also imagine that it won't just be Matchroom fighters you see on your DAZN subscription in the United Kingdom. I'm pretty sure that you'll be able to see Golden Boy's cards on there as well. Moving forward, lest we forget, they're launching this thing in that region of the world with a Golden Boy Promotions card, the Ryan Garcia versus Luke Campbell fight. I imagine that if Canelo Alvarez's existing issues with Golden Boy Promotions and DAZN get reconciled, if these guys can come to some kind of agreement so that Canelo Alvarez can return to the ring, this is where you'll see him fighting. If you're in that region of the world, you'll see him as part of your DAZN subscription. Moreover, a new player has entered into the boxing scenes of several markets around the world, and that can be beneficial as DAZN could potentially funnel all the boxing happening here stateside, for example, to its subscribers in these other markets that are out there. That's basically saying where there was all this hubbub and all this bluster over Sky Sports not having picked up the Vasyl Lomachenko versus Teofimo Lopez fight in the United Kingdom. Neither Sky Sports or BT Sport picked up that fight for their UK subscribers. If you were in the UK and you wanted to see that fight, you likely had to see it via Fight TV, a more obscure platform than either Sky Sports or BT Sport. And neither Sky or BT picked up the Charlo doubleheader. They didn't pick that up either.
That ended up on Fight TV as well.
What I imagine is that you won't just get Matchroom cards, Matchroom USA cards, I should say, and Golden Boy cards as part of your DAZN subscription, depending on what territory you're in. What I imagine is that you'll also get other cards that might be happening here stateside, for example, as DAZN will have the ability to put a bid in for what fights they want to pick up, what fights they want to air in these territories that they operate in. So that if neither Sky Sports or BT Sport are interested in picking up a fight that might be happening here in America, DAZN is another potential buyer, another potential option to market that fight to. Currently, there's talk of the Terrence Crawford versus Kell Brook fight having not been picked up by Sky Sports.
Or BT Sport.
That is a fight that is set to go down before DAZN launches in these 200-plus territories around the world. That fight is set to go down on November the 14th. But that fight is also an example of the kind of fight that DAZN could potentially pick up moving forward. That if neither Sky Sports or BT Sport want to pick up a fight, DAZN is an option. Maybe they'll pick it up.
You can try to sell it to them.
And you'll notice that for this global launch, the price point is significantly less than the price point was when DAZN emerged in the American market. When they emerged here stateside, the initial price point for a month-to-month subscription was something to the tune of $9.99, roughly $10 American. That price point eventually doubled to $19.99, roughly $20 American. This price point that they're emerging with globally
$1.99.
is far less than that one was. You know, they're talking about, what is it, what? $1.99 in pounds, not US dollars, $1.99 in pounds.
And what's that?
That translates into roughly $3 American, just $3. So even if that price point doubles over time, what you're looking at is a subscription of roughly, what, six?
6 pounds.
If it were to double, as currently the price point is set to be, just $3. That's it. A price point, a monthly subscription price of $3. Six! If it doubles over time, though, even if it did, that would still be less than what we were paying here in America when DAZN first launched. And that, my friends, really is value for money. Think about it this way, folks. When neither Sky Sports or BT Sport, those UK broadcasters, when neither of those broadcasters picked up the Vasyl Lomachenko versus Teofimo Lopez fight to be aired in the United Kingdom and other territories, but particular to this conversation, the United Kingdom, when they didn't pick that fight up, Fight TV picked that fight up, that platform. They were the ones that ended up showing it, but they ended up showing it as a pay-per-view that costed the fight fans over there in that part of the world $9.99 in pounds. Whereas this price point for this DAZN subscription is even less than that. So, hypothetically speaking, had a DAZN picked up that fight, not only would you get that, but you would have also got a month's worth of other content, other boxing matches, Matchroom USA cards, Golden Boy Promotions cards, what have you. And this opens a door otherwise unseen by the sport of boxing. This essentially gives all those different pockets of fans scattered out there throughout the globe a chance to see fights anywhere at any time via their subscription. You know, I often think about the metrics associated with this channel, Ring IQ Boxing Talk on YouTube. This really isn't one of the bigger boxing channels that are out there, and as far as boxing channels, even the biggest boxing channels pale in comparison to the biggest YouTube channels overall. However, I often think about the metrics associated with this small boxing channel and how it seems to attract viewers from all around the world. Viewers in Canada, the Philippines, Australia, Ireland, Germany, Nigeria, Mexico, South Africa, the Netherlands, Indonesia, France, the Ukraine, Thailand, Kenya, Japan, India, Italy, Brazil, Russia, New Zealand, Poland, Malaysia, the United Arab Emirates, and so on and so forth. The bulk of the viewers that frequent this channel seem to come from the United States and the United Kingdom. But all these other regions of the world, all these other pockets of boxing fans that frequent this channel, I often think about those metrics and I ask myself, you know, if you could find a way to funnel their viewership, their patronage, to one platform, just one, you could tap into a market, a sizable market that is otherwise unseen, the global market, in a way that it's really never been done before, not when you can reach that many different fight fans from around the world. And rest assured, they are out there in pockets. Some markets are bigger than others, granted. In some parts of the world, there is a much greater demand than in some others, but better still, there are fight fans all over the place. And if you can gain access to them, the potential is limitless. To pour money into the sport and thereby grow the sport benefiting from that, and the fighters themselves and the exposure that that could garner them. It really is quite the undertaking, and DAZN's global expansion plan seems to be moving forward in spite of some of the narratives the usual suspects like to propagate, that DAZN is going bankrupt, that they're going under, that they're in financial trouble, when they're in no more financial trouble than anybody else has been throughout this global pandemic. Of course, DAZN, like many other platforms, like many other outfits, was affected by the COVID-19 virus, the COVID-19 pandemic.
But who wasn't affected by that shit?
Especially in this industry, when this industry was one of the hardest hit industries by the pandemic. It wasn't just DAZN facing tough times. Most anyone and everyone who relies on staging events, sporting events, or even concert events in front of a live audience of some kind, those were the industries that were the hardest hit by the global pandemic. So it wasn't just DAZN going through tough times. Everybody was going through tough times. But certain YouTube channels out there would have you believe that it was just DAZN.
Oh, they're bankrupt.
They're losing money and they're gonna go under. Well, how do you like them apples, eh? This is yet another thing that the usual suspects were wrong about, because DAZN is proceeding as planned. Some postponements aside, some delays, some snafus, DAZN's global expansion plan is moving forward, in spite of what some of these YouTube channels, so-called news channels, would have had you believe. So as of December 1st, he's looking forward to yet another thing, yet another aspect of the sport of boxing that the usual suspects were wrong about. In other news, per a tweet from Michael Benson, Eddie Hearn, with plenty to say about the WBC franchise situation at lightweight. Eddie Hearn told the Ak and Barak show on Sirius XM, "We never wanted this. Haney wanted to win that belt. Haney would have beat Loma just like Lopez. If Haney beats Loma, he becomes a star. But because of the franchise situation, you're protecting your champions. Anyone that has big commercial value, anyone that pays significant sanctioning fees, anyone that could be involved in major fights that could generate a lot of money for that governing body. Let's not mince our words. Bob Arum says Loma shouldn't have to fight a mandatory. Then what's the point in a governing body? We have to encourage greatness. We have to let these fighters strive to fight these people. And now you can't get them. So what's the point?" The franchise designation from the WBC has had an adverse effect on Devin Haney's career that it hasn't had on most other fighters that are out there. You know, when the franchise designation came into being, it all started with Canelo Alvarez. And Canelo Alvarez's mandatory challenger at that time was Jermall Charlo.
Interim champion.
Jermall was adversely affected by this designation because now he could not enforce himself as a mandatory to Canelo Alvarez, Canelo being the first franchise champion.
Couldn't do nothing.
Jermall was subsequently elevated to full-fledged world champion of the WBC in the middleweight division, but Jermall, unlike Devin, had options. You know, he was offered a unification match with Demetrius Andre.
But he never wanted that fight.
And he made that crystal clear on more than one occasion. Better still, in spite of Jermall Charlo being adversely affected by the presence of a franchise champion, that champion being Canelo Alvarez, even Jermall had and still has more options on his table than Devin does.
On his.
Teofimo Lopez is currently in possession of 3 of the 4 world titles in the lightweight division. I say 3 of the 4 because the franchise designation is not a world title. It's not in and of itself. That's why if you take a trip over to BoxRec to see what world titles were on the line in that Teofimo Lopez versus Vasyl Lomachenko fight, what you'll find is that the WBC title isn't listed. The WBA is there, the WBO is there, and the IBF. We also know that the coveted Ring Magazine title was also on the line in that fight. But the WBC world title was not, and that is because franchise status, the franchise designation, is not a world title.
It's not.
If you were to take a trip over to the IBF's current rank standings to see who they recognize as the WBC's lightweight champion in this division, the WBC's lightweight world champion, you won't see the name of Teofimo Lopez. You'll see the name of Devin Haney, because that is the title that he is currently in possession of, and that is the title that Vasyl Lomachenko relinquished when he petitioned for franchise status. Vasyl Lomachenko vacated his world title, and as a result of Devin Haney already having been the interim champion for beating Zaur Abdullaev, he was elevated to full-fledged world champion. I mentioned Jermall Charlo earlier, and the effect that Canelo Alvarez's franchise status had on his career, and I reiterate, Jermall Charlo didn't find himself in a bad way the same way that Devin Haney finds himself in a bad way. It's a different situation.
It's worse.
Jermall Charlo had options and still has options, but for Devin, the options really are far and few. That's why he's fighting Yuriorkis Gamboa. Luke Campbell's fighting Ryan Garcia. Both of those guys are spoken for the time being. Javier Fortuna, who was free after things fell apart with Jorge Linares, they decided to put him in there with Lozado instead of pursuing a fight with Devin Haney. You can fucking forget about Gervonta Davis. He's about to go fight a 126-pounder who just moved up to 130. He's not interested in facing the best and brightest fighters in the lightweight division. And as far as Teofimo Lopez, Bob Arum, in so many words, has made it crystal clear that he puts no priority whatsoever in making that fight. Making that fight between Teofimo Lopez and Devin Haney.
Forget it.
This is a situation that could have been remedied had there been no franchise champion.
How so?
Think about it. If the WBC would have never crowned Vasyl Lomachenko franchise champion, he would have still been the WBC's world champion. And in that Teofimo Lopez fight, which he lost, the title would have changed hands, making Teofimo Lopez the WBC's full-fledged world champion. And if he were still world champion, the then interim champion Devin Haney could have then pushed for his title shot.
Except now, he can't.
Because franchise champions don't have mandatories. Is this Devin Haney's fault? Does he find himself in this situation as a result of something that he did?
No.
All he wanted to do was fight Vasyl Lomachenko and challenge him for the world title, world titles. And he went through the proper channels to do it. He didn't shy away from that challenge the way that Gervonta Davis did for 3 years. He was running towards that challenge. And now, he's on the receiving end of a substantial amount of criticism. Criticism towards his resume and how thin it is. Criticism towards his status as a champion. Some people call him a paper champion, an email champion.
And is any of this his fault?
At a time when Bob Arum is more interested to match his guy Lopez against either Ryan Garcia or Gervonta Davis. At a time when Bob Arum has no interest in matching Teofimo Lopez against Devin Haney. We're supposed to be criticizing Devin Haney.
No, I don't think so.
Because I didn't forget how it is we got here. I didn't forget about the sequence of events that led to this. Ultimately, Devin Haney is being frozen out of the lightweight division. And as a boxing fan, no, I'm not okay with that. Why would I be? I'm not okay when they do it to Terrence Crawford any more than I'm not okay when they do it to Devin Haney.